The Paul Series is new this year as we invite our own teacher scholars to enlighten us with their erudition. This afternoon's presenter is Mr. Nick Galiatsatos. His presentation is entitled The Eucharist, Image, Perfection, and the Spiritual Life. This talk will walk through the Church's teaching on the Eucharist as the source and summit of the Christian life. More specifically, this talk will explore the way in which frequent celebration of the sacrament of the Eucharist is essential for image perfection, the perfection of the Imago Dei, the image of God within our souls. The image perfection aligns our minds, hearts, and wills to God's will for us. Frequent celebration of the Eucharist gives us the daily bread we need to stay on the narrow path. Mr. Nick Galiatsatos is in his second year as theology teacher at Archbishop McCarthy High School. He attained his Master of Arts in Theology at Ave Maria University. There will be an opportunity for you to ask questions or meet with our presenter personally at the end of the talk. Now please welcome Mr. Nick Galiatsatos.
All right, thank you very much. That was a cool intro, teacher scholar. Oh wait, I got a mic. Thank you, Mr. G, the other Mr. G, for putting this together. I think it's really cool. A lot of people don't know, you know, if you don't know, this speaker series is Mr. G's sort of baby. He created this idea, came up with this idea on his own a couple years ago to have people, you know, give theological talks within the school community. And this year he had the idea of letting us teachers give our own talks, particularly on the Eucharist. So that's really cool. And we all appreciate the opportunity to do so. So just a little shout out to him. Today's talk is Eucharist, image restoration, image perfection, and the spiritual life. And I'm going to try to do a couple things at once. A, ask the question sort of, what is it to be human? And how is it that we express our relationship with God through the body, right? Because the sacraments are material things. As a professor of mine once said, you know, the Madonna song goes, I'm a material girl living in a material world. And so as humans, one of the beautiful things about being Catholic is that Christ offers us through the sacraments material signs, material things through which to sort of develop in our spiritual relationship with God. So that's going to be the idea of, okay, what is it about being human that we need to give expression to God through physical gestures, rituals, and material signs? The connection, of course, will be from the Eucharist itself, and then asking the question, okay, what does the Eucharist do for me spiritually then? Why do I need to go to church every Sunday and receive the Eucharist? What's the point? The purpose of the talk is to contribute in any small way that I can to the larger Eucharistic revival movement that began last year in the Feast of Corpus Christi and will continue until Pentecost 2025. So we're in a period of Eucharistic revival, reviving a sense of why it is that we need to go to church and receive the body, blood, soul, and divinity of Christ in the Eucharist. After the coronavirus pandemic, you know, church attendance has dipped drastically. Young people are not going to church with their parents anymore. And, you know, kind of the idea was, well, if I can watch church from home on a live stream, why do I need to go to church? And so this whole idea of the Eucharistic revival is emphasizing the necessity to actually go and physically receive God in the Eucharist. Okay, so in the beginning, here we go. The human being is made in the image and likeness of God. We say this all the time, made in the image and likeness of God. We share in a special way in the divine life, in our gifts, spiritual gifts of intellect, free will, and capacity to love. These are spiritual qualities. And so man is a unity of both body and soul, and we give expression to the spiritual dimension of our being through our physical bodies. We show somebody we love them when we give them a hug, right? We give expression to our spiritual beings, the spiritual dimension of our being through our physical bodies. When God creates us in his image and likeness, we are not necessarily saying that we look like God, although people have been confused with certain, you know, in art, the way that God is depicted as the old man with a beard. The image, when we say we're made in his image, does not refer to the fact that we look like God in any physical way, but is referring to those spiritual unique capacities of intellect, free will, and the capacity to love. So to be stamped, right? We're stamped, our souls are stamped in what in Latin is called the imago Dei, the image of God, refers to the unique spiritual capacities of the human being that render us capable to know, love, and act freely, as God does. Man alone, the church teaches, quote, of all visible creatures are called to share by knowledge and love in God's own life. It's from the Catechism. Man has a capacity to interact with reality and grasp the true essence of things, including the knowledge, the existence of God himself. Man can freely choose what is good over what is evil and can extend outward into personal loving relationship with others. So to become more like God is the spiritual basis of the Christian life. We are seeking to become more like God, more like Christ, to configure ourselves to God. We cannot become God, of course, but we can share in a human way in the eternal and perfect qualities of God as he exists in all of eternity. To become more like God is to become good as God is good, to love more completely as God loves completely, and to choose freely to sacrifice our own self-centered interests for the good of others in community, to live beautifully and seek higher things, to conform our lives to the truth as God himself is truth, to think and to reason more clearly, to seek to know reality and conform our whole being to the reality of what is. Man is totally free to choose to pursue a virtuous life and to choose to be in relationship with God or to fall victim to sin and evil. We choose truth or falsehood, beauty or ugliness. It's up to us. So, in the beginning, and this is just some things, man is a bridge between the physical and spiritual world. We are a substance composed of body. And so we're a spiritual animal and an embodied person, right? Again, our spiritual capacities are expressed through the body. We image, we reflect what God is by virtue of our spiritual faculties. We are most like God when we come to know and love God. We are also made to the image of God in our bodily natures, and we give expression to our spiritual dimension through the body. So why, you know, I'm trying to do a lot in a little bit of time, but it's a big picture. Why a church? Why sacraments? And why Christ on the cross? To understand that, we have to go all the way back to the beginning, of course, with the fall of Adam and Eve. And to understand how it is that the Eucharist contributes to image restoration, we need to understand what it is that needs to be restored. What is it about the image that's in us that needs to be restored? In the beginning, Adam and Eve ate from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Here they are, God bless them. Committing the original side of pride, falling from their original state of grace, and passing on the effects of original sin to the entire human family. So that arrows the fall. We fall from grace, right? Due to original sin, we are all here and now, got all of us, born, fallen, incomplete, with what the church calls concupiscence, the inclination to sin. Our passions and desires are disordered. This is clear to us, right? When we think things we shouldn't think, when we do things we shouldn't do, we recognize that our passions, our desires, our way of being is not as it should be. There's something a bit off. We're out of tune, right? So, and we see the residual effects of original sin early on in the human story when Cain kills his brother Abel. So how do we know that sin is inherited? Well, immediately after the fall, Cain kills Abel, right? So sin is sort of embedded into the fallen nature of the human person. And that's part of the human drama that culminates in Christ offering himself for us, right? We know the story. So no one can escape sin. No one can escape sin. The sins we commit leave wounds in our individualized human natures. It's like a hole in a sock. You can still use the sock, but every time we sin, we're sort of putting little holes in the sock. They leave wounds, these sins, that later can potentially manifest to bigger holes. These wounds show themselves through our disordered appetites, passions, and desires. Even before manifesting in our visible behaviors, disorder becomes apparent in the individual psyche of the human person. We know we are sinful, again, when we choose what we should not choose, when we fear what we should not fear, and desire what we should not desire. This fallen nature, however, does not make us inherently bad or evil. We're not doomed forever. We're not evil. We're still here. We're good. If we exist, we're good. On the contrary, we're simply born out of tune. We do not work as we could. It's like a guitar or a piano that's a little out of tune. And we need God to fix us, to tune us, if you will. And so this is where the sacramental life of the church comes into play, insofar as the sacraments instituted by Christ himself work to restore the image that was lost at the fall and has continued to be muddied through the generationally inherited sin of the human race and our own daily personal sin. We muddy that image, right? It's like it gets blurry. Some dirt gets on there. We have to get rid of that so the image can be restored. And each sacrament, including, of course, the Eucharist, heals these wounds of sin. This divinely wrought work is what can be called the work of, quote, image restoration. And it's through the lens of image restoration that we are going to talk about the Eucharist here today. The Eucharist is the spiritual food, the manna that falls from heaven, the daily bread we need to restore that image of God within us as we continue on our spiritual journeys as human creatures. Right? The Eucharist communes us with Christ, communion. We come into one with Christ and works to realign our will with the divine will. Gradually, not all at once. Maybe it would be nice to take the Eucharist once and then we'd become amazing spiritual monks, but it's gradual. That's why we need to receive it over time, all the time, frequently. Christ works through the Eucharist to restore our natural powers to their original state. Remember, in the beginning, before the sin of Adam, humans enjoyed what is called the state of original justice and holiness. Human nature existed in a state of completion. Prior to sin, there was no disorder in Adam and Eve. But of course, this is not the condition of the human being after the fall. Salvation entails a greater participation in God's own life. And this participation is what we call grace. And we receive these graces through various means. God uses various means to bring about grace in our lives. Most especially, God, through the incarnation, through coming to us as the God-man Jesus Christ, institutes and uses the sacraments to bring about the work of image restoration through his special sacramental graces, right? So the sacraments give us a special grace. And the sacraments instituted directly by Christ himself are the means of our sanctification. We are sanctified gradually through frequent participation in the gifts that God gives us, Christ directly gives us. These sacraments are ritual acts that signify, they're signs that bring about God's sanctity in our lives. The sacraments are causative signs. They effect what they signify. They do what they say. It's almost like a stop sign where everybody would always stop. Not everybody always stops at a stop sign, but the sacraments are causative signs. They literally effect what they signify, right? Baptism, the water of baptism, signifies the cleansing. We are cleansed of original sin through baptism. The same with all the sacraments. So in the Eucharist, the sacrifice of Christ becomes the sacrifice of the members of his whole body. And the priest says, the body of Christ, we are communing not only with Christ, but with the entire church community, the entire family of the church. Here I just have a couple quotes from the Catechism, direct teachings of the church. The famous quote on the front in the top, the Eucharist is the source and summit of the Christian life. And this one is interesting. This is the quote that's usually left out. The other sacraments, and indeed all ecclesiastical ministries and works of the apostolate, are bound up with the Eucharist and oriented toward it. So all the other sacraments are oriented toward the Eucharist, the source and summit. Right? If we think about it, you have to be baptized in order to be eligible to receive the Eucharist. If you are aware of any mortal sin, as we'll talk about later, you must attend the sacrament of confession before being ready again to receive the Eucharist. And so you can do that with all the rest of the sacraments. They're all oriented towards the Eucharist. Through Holy Communion, we unite ourselves to Christ, who makes us shares in his body and blood to form a single body. So the church, the body of Christ, the church, all of us, as well as Christ, are one body. The Eucharist is celebrated in communion with the whole church in heaven and on earth, the living and the dead, and in communion with the pastors of the church, the Pope, the diocesan bishop, the Presbyterian, deacons, and all bishops of the whole world together with their churches. We get the point, the entire church. Right? So Eucharist is binding you together with the entire church. The Eucharist strengthens our charity, which tends to be weakened in daily life. And this living charity wipes away venial sins. Quote, by giving himself to us, Christ revives our loves and enables us to break our disordered attachments to creatures and root ourselves in him. So it aligns us to the contemplation of God, not only in our relationship with God, but with neighbor, right? So it strengthens the bonds of charity with the rest of the church, the other baptized people that make up the church. The more we share the life of Christ and progress in his friendship, the more difficult it is to break away from him by mortal sin. So that we'll talk about a little bit later, but the point is, the more we bind ourselves to Christ, the easier it becomes to avoid sin. And so frequent reception of the Eucharist makes it easier to progress in the virtuous spiritual life. When we tend to move away from church and move away from the reception of the Eucharist, is when we find that we don't have that daily spiritual food to be strengthened and nourished. What is this? Well, I just wanted to point to a couple of prefigurations in the Old Testament that sort of build up to the Eucharist. The Eucharist is instituted by Christ at the Last Supper and completed, of course, at the cross. But the Eucharist is prefigured in many ways in the Old Testament. So God is preparing us for this teaching over time. God is preparing us to receive this teaching over time. Of course, when Christ teaches what is known as the bread of life discourse, when Christ says and institutes the Eucharist, it's still a difficult teaching, and it's still a difficult teaching to this day for many people, this idea that we are communing, eating the body and blood of Christ. But God, the point is, God is preparing us for this teaching in many ways in the Old Testament. In the book of Genesis, the priest Melchizedek, I just love that name, so I wanted to throw Melchizedek in there. The priest Melchizedek offers a bread and wine sacrifice to God. Later at the Exodus, a lamb is offered in sacrifice, what we call the Paschal Lamb. Of course, Christ is now the Lamb of God. A final prefiguration of the Eucharist is the bread-like manna given miraculously each day by God to the Israelites as they traveled for 40 years in the desert before reaching the Promised Land. This context grounds our understanding of what Jesus is doing when he institutes the Eucharist at the Last Supper, the night before he's crucified. When Christ holds up the bread and wine and says, this is my body, this is my blood, he is directly identifying the Eucharist with his real presence, but also we have been prepared, the people of God had been prepared to receive this teaching. Okay. The Eucharist is the sacrifice of the new Paschal Lamb, Jesus Christ. Every time you go to church and the priest lifts up the elevated host and says, behold, the Lamb of God, he who takes away the sins of the world, we are remembering that Christ is the new Paschal Lamb who sacrifices himself. A sacrifice signified by bread and wine, the once and for all sacrifice that gives us the daily food for our journey towards heaven. The Eucharist unites us to Christ and to the entire church, strengthening our bonds of charity and providing the spiritual sustenance for the church to continue her daily work of building up the kingdom on earth. What's the point? What material food produces in our bodily life, communion achieves in our spiritual life, right? So you are what you eat. And so we consume Christ, we receive Christ in us. And so what material food produces in our bodily lives builds us up, strengthens us, gives us energy. Sometimes when we don't eat, we're tired. There's a lot of students in class. I didn't have breakfast. I can't breathe. Well, the same way the material food gives us that sustenance that we need to carry on with our day, communion gives us the spiritual sustenance that we need, right? Communion renews, strengthens, and deepens our incorporation into the entire church body. In the words of St. Paul, because there was one bread, we who are many are one body, and we are all partakers of the one bread. And the bread, of course, is Christ. Now, let's talk about how this sacrament actually works. And here I'm relying upon the tradition of St. Thomas Aquinas and the Thomist tradition. And St. Thomas Aquinas shows, the Thomistic tradition shows, that every sacrament, not just the Eucharist, every sacrament involves three steps. There's a tripartite dimension to the Eucharist. Tripartite just means three, but we like to say tripartite. It sounds fun. There's three steps to the Eucharist. There is what is known as the sacramentum tantum, the ritual, the matter of the sacrament. The res et sacramentum, which is Latin for the thing and the sacrament, or the effect and sign. It's the rite of the sacrament. And thirdly, the res tantum, the thing alone, the final effect, what we receive, the sacramental grace and effect that we receive from the sacrament. Okay, so every sacrament involves three steps. This tripartite dimension to the sacrament is useful to help us understand how it is that sacraments cause grace within us, but also the intermediate step, as we will see in a bit, helps us to understand what is required from us when we participate in the Eucharist. I have a lot of students that always say to me, why can't I just receive the Eucharist if I haven't been to confession, if I'm aware of mortal sin, or if I haven't been baptized, why can't I receive the Eucharist? Well, it's the second intermediary step that will hopefully clear some of these things up. So the first step in Latin, the sacramentum tantum, the sacramental ritual, the basic sign. The sacramental sign is exteriorized. It's physical, right? And of course, with the sacrament is bread and wine, and may also require some interior action. The liturgical rite of the Eucharist begins with bread and wine as the sacramental matter. And it's very fascinating. Why bread and wine? Well, bread, you might say, it signifies basic nutritional sustenance. Eating well leads to physical strength. Bread is a hearty meal, and it's also a humble meal. Everybody has bread, from the peasant to the king. And the same occurs spiritually, right? Think also of how bread is made. Many different small grains of wheat are baked together, and it yields one loaf of bread. There's also wine, same thing. Many different grapes come together to make one glass of wine. The scriptures speak of wine as a divine gift to gladden the heart, the sweetness of wine. Wine is typically shared in the context of community and celebration. Remember Jesus' first miracles at a wedding. There's a celebration. Everybody's happy and dancing. Wine emits an emotion of joy and communal celebration. It's a happy occasion. So we can say that the joy and the sweetness of wine signifies the joy and sweetness of our communion with God in the divine life, right? Many people come together, commune together, and the sign of bread and wine can help us to see how it is that all the many different individual members of the church are baked together to form one body. In the same way that many grapes are crushed to create one bottle of wine. Right? So, to the sacramental matter of bread and wine, the formula is added. When the priest says, this is my body, this is my blood, that's paraphrasing. When the priest says, this is my body, this is my blood, these words signify a real transformation of the bread into the true, but sacramental, substantial presence of the body of Christ, and the wine into the true and sacramental presence of the blood of Christ. The church uses the term transubstantiation, philosophical term, which really means it's the real body and blood of Christ. If you want to be a philosopher, you can go study transubstantiation, right? The substance of bread and wine under the appearance, the physical appearance of bread and wine becomes the body and blood of Christ. Through the priest's consecration of bread and wine, we receive the true presence of Christ's body and blood. And, this is the important part, by extension, we receive everything that is connected with Christ's body and blood, namely his soul and his divinity. So we receive everything that comes with receiving Christ, his soul and his divinity. We receive God. We receive God. And we need that in order to restore the lost image of God that's in us. If you need more God, you need to receive God. So the Eucharist is the whole of Christ, presented to us in the signs of what was bread and wine. That's the first step, right? Matter, the bread and wine, and the priest, through the words, this is my body, this is my blood, transubstantiating the bread and wine into Christ. The second step brings about the rest sacramentum, brings about the final grace of a sacrament. So the second step is the intermediary step between one and three. So before you can receive the grace of the sacrament, before you can receive the fullness of the grace of the sacrament, you have this second intermediary step. The external rite, excuse me, really does bring about a spiritual reality, but sometimes, due to an obstacle in the recipient, it may not result in the person receiving the final sacramental grace. This is where our spiritual disposition is necessary, right? Every time Father Edivaldo gives Mass and he says, wait, I can't do the accent. But if you haven't gone to confession, don't receive the Eucharist if you're aware of mortal sin. This is where that second sort of intermediary step goes in, because sometimes we are aware of mortal sins that we have committed. We haven't gone to confession. We receive the Eucharist anyways. The idea that the church teaches is that you will not receive the fullness of the sacramental grace if we approach the Eucharist incompletely, with some deceit in our hearts. God's grace will work in his own way, but in order to receive the fullness of the sacrament, we do need to approach the sacraments with a proper disposition. The same is true with confession. If you're not truly contrite and sorry, if you don't really feel like what you did was a sin, and you go in there and you say, I sinned, we don't receive the fullness of the grace. So this is why the church teaches that anyone conscious of a grave sin must receive the sacrament of reconciliation before receiving communion. We always must remember, as we say right before we receive the Eucharist, Lord, I'm not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed, right? We require a spiritual disposition of humility. We're not worthy to receive God under our roofs, and so we want to make ourselves clean and prepared to receive God is the idea. Right? Receiving the Eucharist physically is reserved for baptized persons who are spiritually united to Christ by virtue of the seal imprinted on their souls when they are baptized. And to commit a grave sin, what the church calls mortal sin, is to be unfaithful to Christ, who really is our friend, and we want to be honest with our friends. We want to be honest with people that we love. And so to physically receive the Eucharist in a state of mortal sin is to do a further grave sin. And in a way, you're making light of the great gift of the Eucharist that God offers us to us freely out of love. God offers us freely the gift of the Eucharist, and so we should receive the Eucharist from a disposition of accepting that gift with love. And so if we commit a grave sin, we must first ask for forgiveness in the sacrament of penance to position us in what is known as a state of grace. We want to be in a state of grace. And when we are in a state of grace, when we receive the Eucharist will yield very powerful spiritual effects. Okay, now let's just give an example. I hope I'm not going too long. Now let's give an example. Consider the following scenario. God bless him. I don't want to judge a book by a cover, but this, you know, this guy, let's say, whoever this kid is, suppose someone goes to their friend's house and wants to play the new Legend of Zelda game that came out a couple months ago. I don't know if it's any good, but he plays the new Legend of Zelda game on his Switch. And this guy, he likes the game so much, he steals it from his friend. He doesn't tell his friend anything. He dips out the back window and he leaves. He steals his friend's Legend of Zelda game. He has no intention of returning the game. He has no intention to admit to stealing it. He doesn't feel bad. He says, I don't care. I don't feel bad for stealing it. It's my game now. He moved his seat, lose his feet, whatever it's called. So I'm taking his The Legend of Zelda game, and I don't feel bad. I am an unrepentant sinner, right? And let's consider this a mortal sin, right? Later that day, the Zelda thief goes to Mass with his family. And at communion time, he did not go to confession. At communion time, the Zelda thief walks up to the priest and receives the Eucharist, right? The question here, of course, is did he receive the fullness of the sacraments? The answer is both yes and no. Because yes, he consumes the sacred host, the body and blood of Christ, truly present under the appearance of bread and wine. However, because of his unrepentant robbery of this game, which has cut him off spiritually from God, the thief cannot be further united to Christ and his church in charity, which is the third and final sacramental grace, the third step that we receive when we participate in the celebration of the Eucharist. So in this way, the thief does not receive the final grace, sacramental grace of the Eucharist. This intermediate step between the rite itself and the final grace received is essential to understand the appropriate spiritual disposition we should have when receiving the Eucharist, and for that matter, when celebrating any of the sacraments, right? So use this as an example. When we commit mortal sins and we approach God without repentance, without confessing our sins, we sort of cut ourselves off from receiving the fullness of the sacramental graces that are available to us in our celebration of the Eucharist. That's why it's so important. And that's why, in the beginning, as I said, all the sacraments are bound up to and ordered towards the Eucharist. That is the beautiful connection between confession and the Eucharist. Okay, so the final step, what is known as a res tantum, gives us spiritual strength through union with Christ and his church. So assuming you're in a state of grace, assuming after stealing the Zelda game, your friend calls you and says, dude, you stole my game. And you say, you know what, man? Yes, I'm sorry. I'm going to go to confession and I'm going to give you your game. I'm sorry for what I did. And you go to church and you confess your sins to the priest and you make yourself clean. Then, of course, you will be eligible to receive the fullness of the grace. Of course, we could use other examples, but I felt this one was a fun, harmless example. But you can use other examples of the mortal sins that we commit that need to be cleansed, that need to be confessed so that we can properly receive Christ at the Eucharist. And of course, God's grace is always active in some way at each of the three sacramental steps. We reserve the word sacramental grace for step three, right? Res tantum, because this is the final end of that particular sacrament. Each sacrament gives us a special grace. Each step of these sacraments illustrates how God moves and perfects us in a dynamic transformation in his life. The first step signifies the active work of Christ, who institutes each sacrament and gives grace and the virtues in the sacraments. Then we move to step two, which involves our spiritual configuration to Christ. That's our spiritual work, step two. We need to be configured properly to Christ in order to receive the fullness of the graces in that next step. This then leads us to step three, which is a special particular sacramental grace, which is a participation in the divine life. Okay. Each sacrament gives us a particular way of participating in the divine life of Christ. In the case of the Eucharist, the sacrament of grace we receive is unity with Christ and his church, and charity. It strengthens the bonds of charity and inspires us to build up the kingdom of heaven on earth. Mr. Gavone gave a talk a couple months ago about the connection between the Eucharist and social justice, how consistent, frequent reception of the Eucharist inspires the church to go out and through the strength, the spiritual strength of charity that we receive, to go out and build up the kingdom, to go out and do acts of charity, to feed the poor, to clothe the needy, to forgive people. Maybe you're arguing with one of your friends and there's drama, and maybe now I feel strengthened to reach out an olive branch and forgive them, and to build up the church, to build up charity. So, by eating, consuming the supernatural meal, the consumption of the Eucharist helps us stay on our feet, our spiritual feet, and continue onwards in this world as we journey towards heaven, right? Because this life is a journeying towards heaven. And so we want to prepare ourselves to meet God when we die. And the way we practice and get prepared to meet God when we die is through the sacramental life of the church, especially the Eucharist. By meeting Christ in the Eucharist consistently, it's almost as though when you die and you are face to face with God, he'll be familiar to you. You've You've communed with him. You've broke bread with him throughout your life. You've prepared yourself for that final meeting. And if we've been wavering through light sin, the Eucharist will forgive our sins and realign us on the straight and narrow path. The idea is you're falling off the wagon. You need to get the food to get back on the straight and narrow path. Right? The Eucharist unites us with Christ's sacrificial love and enables us to offer our own sacrifices of our lives by taking up our own crosses daily and to serve our neighbors in charity. The Eucharist unites us with Christ and is the promise that we will be present with Christ when we die in heaven. Here at the Mass, every time at Mass, people can receive the grace from the Eucharist by being physically present, spiritually cooperative, and approach the Eucharist with the appropriate spiritual attitude, spiritual disposition, and readiness. This is something called active participation, which is documented in the Church's Vatican II document called Sacrosanctum Concilium. The idea is for us to be active participants in our celebration of the Eucharist, when we receive Christ, to be prepared, to be ready, to be active in our participation in receiving God. The highest form of participating in the Eucharist is by receiving the Holy Communion physically, right? Receiving the body and blood of Christ. Okay. Lastly, almost done. The sacraments and the moral life, the spiritual life, of course, go together. The question, of course, is why? As we said early on, now I'm going to bring the beginning back to tie it all in, hopefully in a nice bow. Human beings live out their spiritual aspirations towards God in their physical bodies, through the senses, the five senses, through taste, through touch, through smell. The human being, the calling, the vocation of the human being is to submit our body to the soul and the soul to God, to order ourselves appropriately to God, to order our passions, our thoughts, our desires, our intentions, everything that we do, everything that we think, everything that we say, to be ordered towards the higher things, to be ordered towards God, to be ordered towards truth and love, the beauty of who God is, right? So everything that we say should be submitted to the higher order of things, everything that we do. The way that we exist physically should reflect higher spiritual reality, basically God, perfection. Recall Christ's words to the apostles when he catches them sleeping. And I always use this example, right? Christ goes right before he's about to be betrayed. Christ goes to pray in the Garden of Gethsemane, and he tells the apostles, wait here, please. Keep watch. And he comes back and the apostles are sleeping. He says, what the heck? You couldn't just stay awake? The spirit is willing, but the flesh is very weak. So sometimes we may will to, be in perfect relationship with God. I don't want to sin. I'm going to avoid sin and love God and love neighbor. But our flesh sometimes falters. Our flesh sometimes works against us. And so the Eucharist, receiving the physical Eucharist, is also helping to align our physical bodies to what it is that we might will on a deeper spiritual level. We need to align the body to the soul and the soul to God. We are called to live an integrated, fully integrated and harmonious life with God. So to be more complete as humans, we must live out our intellectual and voluntary lives, the things that we do, the things that we think about, the things that we choose, the way we behave, the media we consume, the things that we look at on the internet, the music that we listen to, everything, our senses, our psychological lives, our emotional lives, how we speak about it ourselves to ourselves, what we think about ourselves, how we talk about other people. We live this out all, everything, our entire being, body and soul, in the service of higher truth and love, in the service of God. And we are called to align all aspects of our being to God. Right? And in this way, there is a rightly ordered hierarchy that moves us from the body to the invisible spiritual reality of who God is. We move from the body up to God. Part of this means that when we approach God spiritually by acts of worship and prayer, We need to do so in an embodied material way, sacraments, material way. These physical gestures and external rituals help us elevate our whole self, body and soul, towards God. Right? Think about, you kneel when you pray, you look up at the sky when you're praying to God, God help me. He's not up there. But we need material physical gestures and ritual acts, which is most complete in the church, in order to elevate ourselves and align ourselves with God, to keep us focused really on God. Okay, so religious exteriority, external acts of religious expression, it's part of the nature of what it is to be a human being. That's clear. Human beings are the kind of beings that must give material expression to their interior spiritual religious dispositions. We do this through our gestures of our body and through external ceremonies, mass. One of the consequences of the fall, we heard, is that we are no longer fully aligned with God. The human person becomes distracted. People lose interest in God. They'd rather listen to, I don't know, other things or watch other things, not think about God. And we become fully interested in the world of the senses, material things, and sensible pleasures. Humans in this fallen state lose focus on the transcendent mystery of God. It's only when we die and go to heaven that we're going to be in direct contact with God for all of eternity and be able to contemplate the mystery of God forever. Here, we're distracted, we're physical fallen. So, what's... All right. So, the sacraments are necessary for us. It's necessary insofar as they invite humans in the fallen world to discover God in material things. So God almost does a little reverse Uno card. He's like, oh, okay, you can only exist in the world of sensible materiality. I'm going to make myself present. Through the incarnation, becoming man, and through the sacraments, I will make myself present and available through the material things. Right? So the sacraments, again, work to repair and restore the right ordering of body to soul and soul to God. Body, soul, soul to God. The sacraments also serve to correct and protect against any potential errors human beings may fall into in their worship. This is the golden calf, right? Moses goes up to talk to God on Mount Sinai, and by the time he comes down, the Israelites have fallen into false worship. So you might think about the sacraments as being, keep your eyes here, right? Stay focused. I gave you the sacraments. Christ instituted the sacraments. Christ, we have the mass that the church gives us, the appropriate way to worship and think about God, the appropriate way to make contact with God. The sacraments are those material signs, material gifts that help us avoid falling into our own superstitions. And maybe some of us have our friends or people that we know. They don't go to church, but they have their own sacraments. They have their own way of communicating with what they call God in a way that is disordered, in a way that is not proper worship. Not to get too much into it, but, there are a lot of these new age ways that people use as ways to make contact with God that are not sacraments, that are not right worship. Tarot cards, I don't know, things like this. The tarot card is like their God, their sacrament. This is how I have contact with the divine, right? Well, no. Anyways, how to say that. The sacraments, as I said, serve to correct and protect against any potential errors. Superstitions and other false forms of worship are a direct result of the fall. Human beings who do not know God well or do not know how to worship God appropriately often produce or fabricate their own religious customs or superstitious practices that, in fact, can endanger them spiritually. It can work against them. This new age forms of worshiping and thinking about God can actually do damage to your soul because you're not connecting with God, connecting maybe with something else. Right? So it can endanger you spiritually because it can lead you away from true knowledge of God and a true way of relating to God. These sacraments then, most fully in the Eucharist, come to rectify and purify as well as elevate our human religious tendencies. God takes the material signs of the Eucharist and elevates them so that we can have direct contact with the true God. The true God. That's the idea. Participation in the sacraments, particularly the celebration of the Eucharist, can be said to be the most fully human way to realign ourselves with God, restore that lost image or that muddied image of God that is within us, and can allow us to live according to our true design, right? So as we walk up the hill of this life of being human, which is hard, we fall, but we keep climbing the mountain. And the idea is Christ has given us the beautiful gift of the Eucharist, himself, his true body, blood, soul, and divinity. God has given us the gift of himself that is made very easily available to us through the material sign of bread and wine so that we can get that spiritual sustenance that we need so that we don't falter, you know, so that we could keep climbing up the mountain. And the hope is, you know, whether you, by the time you leave this life, you know, you've had the daily bread that has prepared you to make that direct contact with God, that face-to-face encounter with God when it's time to move on to the next life. So that's the Eucharist. That's it. That's all I got. Thank you. I guess I should do questions. Yes.
Yeah, thank you for that excellent exposition. Unfortunately, so many Christians are unaware of the importance of the Eucharist. And we know in studies recently, in decades, faithful and engaged Catholics promote the fact that even weekly practitioners of the Eucharist do not understand fully what the Eucharist is. Some might even deny that it's truly the body of Christ. Right? Do you have any, as you see it, what might be the most effective ways to get to the kind of the regular Catholic? Maybe on top of that, not just have those who don't feel that going to Mass is all that important, help impress upon them the what the Eucharist is and the importance of it.
Yeah, there's a lot there. In a way, I sympathize a bit with at least young people, because I know when I was growing up and my mom, you know, she wasn't a theologian in any way. She was like, oh, that's God. And I was like, wait, that doesn't really, like, I don't get it. And I think sometimes poor catechesis, maybe poor teaching when we're younger of what it is that God is doing in the Eucharist can serve to, when people get older, sort of be unaware of what it means to say that the Eucharist is the body and blood of Christ. I also think that we live in a very scientific, rationalistic world that requires direct evidence for things, and we sort of place limits on God's grace and God's power, really, God's ability, you know, to become man in the person of Jesus Christ, to become fully present in the sacraments, to have his, you know, body, blood, soul, and divinity truly present in, under the, you know, the species of bread and wine. These are things that in the modern world are a little bit difficult. So I would say just an increase in faith and piety, proper teaching to young people, and also a frequent reception of the Eucharist. It's strange, but I found that even when I returned to the church when I was in college, and I just started going to Mass on Sundays, and I said, okay, I believe this is God. I don't necessarily understand the fullness of what that means, but I'm just going to start going to church and receive him. I found that just consistently and frequently participating in the Eucharist actually increases my faith and my conviction that this is God. And I think first getting people to Mass so that they can have that personal encounter with God, and so they can have that real period of reflection after you receive the Eucharist. We always say that during Mass, like, this is a time for you to sit, close your eyes, and pray, and have a conversation with God. Allowing for those sort of periods of encounter, I think, are helpful. I remember last, when was this? The beginning of this year, March for Life, we went to Washington, D.C., and they had a period where it was Eucharistic Adoration. A bunch of students from here and a bunch of students from all over the world come to Washington, D.C. There was Mass, and there was an hour of Eucharistic Adoration. And a bunch of kids were just crying. They're like, Mr. G, I don't know why I'm crying. I just feel so happy, and I feel so loved. I was like, well, it was because, you see, that's God right there in the Eucharist, present. And God's extending himself out to you. And they were just crying, sitting there like, I don't even know why I'm crying. And it was at that moment that a lot of those students who maybe didn't understand why, you know, maybe didn't go in there fully believing that God is present in the Eucharist. By the time they left, they were like, okay, I feel God. And so I think offering in periods of encounter, we have Eucharistic Adoration now, thank God. Deacon is offering Eucharistic Adoration Mondays and Wednesdays after school, every day, every Monday and Wednesday after school. Offering for those encounters, I think, can increase a deeper faith and belief in what's going on when you receive God in the Eucharist. Yes.
For me, it's very
strong. Thank you for that. Yes. The daily bread. The daily bread. Anybody? Yes? Yes, I would agree with that. And I would say, you know, as intellectual as Catholicism is, and that's one of the things that drew me to the church, is how intellectual the tradition, St. Thomas Aquinas and philosophy and all this theological tradition, it fascinated me. Like, wait, there's, you know, this isn't just blind faith. Catholicism offers reasons for why we believe what we believe. And there's this whole theological, philosophical tradition of the church that helps us to understand the faith more. It's so rich. In the tradition, it also is it's faith. It's a personal encounter with God. And I think, yes, I agree with you 100%. When we look at it, when we look at mysteries, when we look at church teachings from a position of pure intellectualism, you miss out on that personal faith encounter. And that's, yeah, I really do encourage, go to church, receive the Eucharist, go to Eucharistic Adoration, even if you don't think it's going to do anything. Well, let's see. You know, give yourself occasions to be with God and sit in direct presence of God. And as we said in the back, you know, it's the daily bread, it's the sustenance you need to keep you aligned. So, yes, I agree. Thank you for that.